Is there anything that you're specially afraid of?
Well, I'm afraid of not being able to write anymore.
Things had gone another way, she would have liked to have been the new Plato, and as it is, she produced rather sort of transparent GCSE style analyses of Plato.
I think you've absolutely hit the bullseye. I think that is actually why she, I mean, no doctor would agree with what I'm about to say. I think that is why she developed dementia, because I think during the muddle that she realized was her philosophical outlook on life. While writing the last lectures, she was reduced to first depression and then despair. It was very, very sad seeing her during those years. It went on for about 2 years. She kept writing and rewriting that bloody book. And one could tell, even before it came out, that it was going to be bad. And one could tell she knew it was bad. And one could tell that she didn't really know how to do philosophy.
But was it really so devastating, this realization that she wasn't one of the greats that she admired?
Yes.
At such a deep level?
I really do think that. I think that is why. It makes her sound ridiculous if I say this, but I think she was as vain in a way as that.
But also as sincere. It's a sign of sincerity.
She was deeply sincere, and of course it was very, very lovable, and it was like the sort of ambition which a very young person would have. I mean, when we're 16, we think we will be... Well, if we're good at art, we think we'll be Picasso. And then when you're a bit older, you realise it's okay being as good as Eric Revilliers. In fact, it'd be a jolly good thing to be as good as him. Some people would never get over that, and therefore they wouldn't do anything. And she reached that point at the age of about 70.
Gerard got up and went to the shelves, knowing where to look, and as he touched the books, he felt some fierce and agonizing sense of the past. It's gone, he thought, the past. It is irrevocable and beyond mending and far away, and yet here it is, blowing upon one like a wind. I can feel it, I can smell it, and it's so sad, so purely sad.
Politics. Leave the room to itself. Compare it to a sleeping living creature. Time is the dark packed house of this place, the luck of the desert cut into the floor of the desert. Everything's ready. A light burns wherever necessary. Like skin, like a prison, each thought's an instant ruin. Leave the room to itself. Here's a needle. Here is the sea.
You've got to have the courage to destroy what you think is no good and reject it. The courage to hold on at a certain moment,
this is rather hard to explain, perhaps, but there's, I think the tendency, this is a general moral thing, I think, but it's sort of thinking of it in terms of creation of art, that there's a very strong temptation, if one can do something moderately well, to move very quickly from the moment when you think, well, this is all provisional, this is a sketch, this is not really the finished thing, to then thinking, oh, well, now it's too late. Actually, it is the finished thing. I'll jump from saying it's too soon to saying it's too late. And it's the middle, it's in between these two things. This is the area that you've got to enlarge. This is where the courage comes in, where you've got to say, well, I'm not going to finish this now. I don't regard it as finished, and I'm not going to say it's too late. I'm not going to say it's all run on too far and gone too long. I'm going to hold on to it very, very closely and make it better and think in a way that really hurts. You know, when doing philosophy, thinking often hurts. I think that the interior of every human mind, one can't test this statement, is a place of very, very strange things, very deep fears, deep longings, imagery of all kinds, and far more extraordinary than anything that psychoanalysis can reveal. In a way, there's so little is known about the minds of individuals that it's dangerous to make quasi-scientific generalizations about them. This, again, is why I think the novel's a very important form, because it's a way of talking about people and about good and evil, and doing it without, not as a scientist, but as a reflective observer.